Welcome to this talk. As you know, my company is Let's Go, where I'm a data engineer. I'm going to start with a small introduction to us as a company. And Let's Go is a second-hand market, mainly in the mobile channel, but we have also a web page. And we started in 2015. And since then, we have had a phenomenal growth. So the amount of data we need to manage today is quite large. And now our top market is Turkey. And despite that, we have offices in both in Barcelona and in Istanbul. But now we have open recruiting to any place in both countries, in Turkey and Spain. And as I was saying, when the company started in 2050, like many companies, it started as a monolith. However, if growth means the same for you as for me, that means trouble. And pretty soon, we started migrating to an ecosystem of microservices. And as you know, an ecosystem of microservices means that you have also a society of teams that need to collaborate between them. And the way to keep the collaboration between teams in terms of data, it was done by sending and receiving many, many events. And at the beginning, it was more or less like a free-for-all. Everyone could subscribe to any other event, and then permissions were very constrained. So either you are able to tap everything that is produced or nothing that is produced. But later on, as we were growing, we implemented some data platform facility and some database to manage that amount of events that now are more than 1,000. And that meant to have security controls, for example. Otherwise, it's impossible to comply with regulations like CCPA or GDPR. And we are going to talk about some of the principles and how we made this possible. And I want to go back to the title of the talk, that is Data Governance in Streaming. Scale. And let's start with data governance. Data governance means that there is some guarantees about your data. The very minimum guarantee is that you have a minimum of quality. And one way to do that is to have some kind of format representation that you know that, for example, some fields are present, some other fields are optional. They are always of the same type or a given type, and you can rely on them. But that's the bare minimum. On top of that, it's very nice to be able to catalog your data. So you know which event exists, what each field means, and also especially where the private information about the users is in each of the fields. Because as you can see in the tag cloud on the right, there is a lot of things around the world of data that need to be taken care of. And some of the words like CCPA or GDPR are privacy regulations. But even if we don't have those privacy regulations, we need to pay attention to these kind of things. Because if you don't manage the data, you are the path of minimum resistance is to have access to everything from everywhere. And that means business risk. So it's not only to comply with the regulation. You want to be able to know where the private information is and who needs to use it, so you can have you follow the principle of minimum privilege in your platform. Otherwise, it's very difficult to manage. And also, this kind of philosophy allows you to implement things like data minimization. That is a concept that comes from the German law that predates the GDPR. And sorry, German speakers, but that long word, I'm going to pronounce it as Datenschutzgrundgesetz. It means data minimization. And that's a very nice principle that says that you should not design any business function or application using more data or more private data than the bare minimum to comply with the function you want to do. Otherwise, it's unjustified and it's a risk that you should not take. And let's focus on the streaming part. If you do this governance, that means checking the properties of your data, the data integrity, data quality, and also the part of the governance related with access control and privacy. If you do it in a streaming, it's like you follow this path towards the light. But that's you need to do some work. You need to implement it. And the typical failure mode is if you deviate to the left and you don't do that in a streaming, you can have that governance, but done in batch. So you can do your data integration overnight, and you can have your reports integrating data of your of very distant parts of your company, but that creates silos in real time because you can only join the data the 1 hour later or 1 day later, and in real time you cannot use the data, the useful data that you have in one service that is able to emit in a real time event in another service. And the other failure mode that if we deviate to the right is when you don't have any access control and every microservice can access the events generated by any other microservice. And this is the access all the things reckless behavior. So let's try to find a way to go with the state towards the light at the end of the path. And let's focus also on the scale. And by scale, I mean two different things. We can scale in the number of events and in the amount of traffic we have. That kind of scaling means that you need to have some platform to which you can add more resources to handle more load. And this is the cost of your platform per user or per event doesn't grow. Because otherwise you could scale in load, but not in, you are not viable as a business. We have solved that by relaying and putting in the center of our platform Kafka that is highly scalable. But the other dimension is more challenging. And that dimension is the organization. So you can grow 10x in traffic, but you can also grow 10x in number of teams and number of different kinds of events and different kinds of private information to manage and different and the relationship between the teams is not going to grow linearly, it's going to grow quadratically. And if you don't want to end with a pile of ifs for all the special cases, you need to make some kind of separation between the data platform and the teams and find some way to manage that without doing a lot of cases. And we will see how at NetGo we have found a way to scale linearly also in the number of teams. And I can advance that at the center of this solution, we have schemas. And schemas can be used in different ways with different effects on the flexibility, rigidity, and freedom for the team. So we can make two axes. In one axis, we have from centralism to anarchy. In the stream, with anarchy, the team can do whatever they want with the data. They don't need to talk to anyone, and they can go very fast. And in the centralist extreme, all decisions are taken in a central place, and you can imagine this is slow. And in the other dimension, we have no warranties or a strong warranty. One of the typical things you can do is to say that your events are just JSON. So you don't have any schema, and the only warranty that you give to the other teams is that their parse JSON function is not going to throw an exception. Well, that's very flexible, but it's going to make exploiting the data very difficult and manage the privacy extremely difficult. In this other corner, we have the distributed monolith. This is when you don't have really microservices because you need to coordinate the deployment, because you need to have exactly the same version of the data, maybe the library used to produce or consume the data everywhere. And if in an architecture you need to deploy at the same time two services, they are not independent. And it's called, it's in fact a monolith that is broken down in several machines, but it's still a monolith. I suppose you were expecting now some technology appear in this corner, the unicorn technology that gives you infinite flexibility and strong guarantees. Unfortunately, we don't have that. At LetGo, what we use is Avro, because we can evolve schemas with it. Let's take a look at Avro. Avro is a serialization technology. That means that you can convert your messages into a network format that you can use to send the message or to store it. And it's a schema driven. You cannot use Avro without having a schema. And that's good because we want to have some description of the data we are going to send. And it supports JSON and binary representation. The binary representation is the standard. That representation is very compact, and it's also very fast to parse. And because you don't need to be splitting the text to see where the field starts and ends, is with the main cons of using a binary serialization format is that you need tooling to inspect the messages. But as I was saying, you can use Avro with JSON, and it's pretty much a trade-off between readability, compatibility, and so on. At LetGo, we have support for both technologies, and it's a matter of what do you want to use in yours. And one of the most important points, apart from being evolvable, is that it's polyglot. You are not tied to a single programming language or technology. And in fact, at LetGo, we have two main programming languages, Scala and PHP, and we can use those schemas from both technologies, both programming languages. But the most important thing in this case for the flexibility is that schemas can and do evolve. There are some rules. Not every change is compatible. If you want to keep backward or forward compatibility, there are some checks that the Avro library can do for you. If you follow that rules, that gives you the flexibility to, as a producer, start producing the new version of the event, maybe with some additional fields, without needing to stop or redeploy the consumers. And of course, if the change is too extreme, you will need to create an incompatible change, or better, a new version of the schema produced maybe in a separate topic. So the users, the consumers who want to access the new data, they can switch to the new topic after they change their code. In practice, the setup we have is that when a new event want to create a new event type or want to modify an existing schema, there is a central repository in which you can open a pull request, and that repository is connected through Jenkins. We have a CI/CD pipeline in Jenkins that is making many checks. Some of the checks are related with compatibility with the previous version of the schema, if you are modifying. And that's done with the collaboration of the schema registry. It is the piece of the Kafka ecosystem that is able to manage those schemas. Apart from that, we have many checks of conventions that we use at LetGo. We detect some bad good and bad practices, and we provide warnings. And after all those texts are green, and someone has reviewed the pull request, and this is most of the times this is done within the same day the pull request is open. we can approve it and publish the schema. In production, this schema registry is used with Kafka, and we will have a producer and consumer processes. Because Kafka is the brokers are unaware of the content that you have in the messages, there is something that is doing the schema registry in runtime. That is, when you want to produce the standard library, it's going to contact the schema registry and it's going to say, "Hello, Mr. Registry, I want to produce with this schema." The schema registry is going to give the producer the ID of the schema, so you don't need to send the whole schema with the message, and you send the binary data. And the consumers are going to read those events, and bear in mind that when you build your consumer, maybe you have compiled against some version of the schema. If at some point you receive a new version of the schema, you take the ID, I mean the library, the client library, take the ID, retrieves the schema, and that's the evolution in place. And that means that with your version of the schema, maybe there is a new field with a default value. So if you don't use that field, you ignore it. If some field was removed, then you get the default value filled in automatically. And this is the setup that allows you the flexibility while keeping some contract. But then we have the other part of the puzzle. We want also to manage the private information, to know where the private information is. And this is like the what is Waldo game? Because if you are a data engineer like me, and there is like 1,000 event types, sometimes it's not obvious which where is the email in all those 100 events. Because maybe the field is not called exactly email, or maybe the user ID appear, but it's not called user ID, it's called sender ID, or receiver ID, or maybe it's just sender. The ones that have that knowledge are the teams that produce, that curate that information. And we want also to avoid writing a pile of ifs. So the solution is to use tagging. And that tagging can be added to the schema. Then if you think about that, the teams are already writing the schemas. So it's very sensible to ask also the team to add that tagging information while they write or modify the schema. And fortunately, Avro can be extended with arbitrary metadata. In our case, the field we have used is called let go properties. There is some places in its type definition in which you can plug these additional properties, and the official Apache Avro library is going to parse the schema and give you that as a dictionary. So you can further process it. The easiest translation of this is what you have on the left. That is just an entity. While on the right, we have a more complex version that allows you to link the private information to some other field. And in that case, that's used because sometimes you have several user IDs. And imagine you have a domain event in which you have a chat message, and there is the ID of the sender and the ID of the receiver, and you have the IP of the user sending the message. Well, you know that that IP is related with the sender ID. But if you don't add it to the tag, we cannot do automatic processing of the event for doing the data governance. And of course, the Apache Avro library doesn't parse this metadata. We need to do it. We have a library that is called Wino, and it's called Wino because it's used for telling about the window, the green from the tap, which, you know, like in the icon of the library. And this library is parsing those pieces of metadata and also is able to take ACLs or from some database that is called the DataGov database. That is the place in which we centralize which pieces of private information each team has access to for processing. And the data processing, the data protection officer is the figure in the company that rubber stamps that this team is able to access. For example, imagine you have a team that is on charge of the newsletter of the company. That team will have some ACL giving them access to the email, but maybe they don't have access to the IP of the user because they don't need to. The kind of actions that this Winnow library is able to do at the field level is, for example, remove fields or hash fields. Hashing fields is useful because you can have a team that maybe is interested in the email, but they only want to count unique emails. So if you have access to the hash of the email, you can do that function with less risk than having the actual data. Well, once we have this, we need to run it. And this is the digamos, the life cycle of the events in real time. The services of each team or squad, as we call them, let's go, they work with a set of topics, Kafka topics, that are isolated from the rest of the teams because they don't have permission to access other one. And that is in the tier one. Tier zero is the place where all the private information that should be aggregated is conducted. And you can see that the topics with private information are in red, with arbitrary private information. Then we apply the gatekeeper, that is a process that is checking that the events have good data quality, they match with the schema, otherwise they are going to be reported, we have alarms, we have some dashboard, and the result is validated topics that have, we have the JSON version and the Avro version, so you can choose whichever. And the data pump is the piece that is using Winnow to do the governance in real time, sending it to the green topics. So the teams can access private information from other teams, but only if they have permission. And we have completed the whole cycle. I want just to emphasize the four properties of this approach, that is first is self-service, the meta, because the teams configure the data and that drives the behavior of the platform. And it's metadata driven because schemas and ACLs drive everything. It's focused to evolvability. And finally, there is privacy safe default. If you start a new team and you don't get any additional permission, you cannot access private information from any other team. And that's safe by default. And that's the vision that we have implemented at Telco. And now I think we have a couple minutes for questions, maybe. Meanwhile,
yeah, thanks a lot, Sebastian, for this awesome talk. I think there was like some really good best practices and really, really interesting to see how you tackle the personal private information and GDPR requirements at Letgo. Let's check if there are some questions from the audience. So I have a question. Is there like anything that you would wish from Apache Avro, for instance? Is there like a feature that you think would make your life easier? Well, or do you think it's pretty, yeah, Apache Avro, I mean, or do you think there's like something, it's already good for what it's doing?
We should distinguish two things, the Apache Avro standard and the implementation. I think the standard is nice as it is, but the implementation is the Java-based and mutable. using inheritance. And I think that because our code base for manipulating this is written in Scala, I would like to have a native implementation in Scala in which you have base classes and they are immutable and it's easier to transform the values. Because I was writing some wrapping code to work around this and keep it same. Imagine that we know we have two implementations of we know. One is for streaming, so it goes with the Spark, and we need to transform that metadata into a Spark operation, and that's a little bit tricky. And the other is with normal data points. That's a little bit easier. Imagine doing recursion with things that are very nullable and object. So that will be an improvement.